The greatest artists of modernism are today enshrined in the museums of Paris, the city that had been home for many of them between the wars. Although Paris now claims credit for nurturing the international avant-garde, this is a self-serving rewriting of what really happened. Almost none of these celebrated paintings was bought for French museums until after the Second World War. Conveniently forgotten is the fact that before the war, in the 1930s, modernist artists in France were pilloried by the public and legislated against by the French government. And in a supreme irony, modernism was saved by the forces most hostile to it, the Nazis.
Et ça, c'est un petit souvenir de Miro. Il m'avait donné ça quand je suis parti à la guerre comme porte-bonheur.
Four years before the invasion of France, Hitler, the amateur watercolorist, went to war against modern art. He launched an aesthetic pogrom. Many avant-garde artists were Jewish, and the Nazis saw modernism as a Jewish conspiracy to corrupt German art. The Nazis emptied German museums of avant-garde paintings. Then, with an exhibition held in Munich in 1937, entitled Entartete Kunst, or Degenerate Art, they made modern art the subject of public ridicule. The Degenerate Art Show set out to mock the adventurous shapes of modernism, its brave new colors and distorted spaces. The German public loved it and flocked to the exhibition in large, enthusiastic numbers. The popular success of the Munich show was sealed when its paintings were later auctioned. Modern masterpieces sold for a pittance. What was unsold was burnt. France fell quickly to the invading Germans. 10 million people took to the roads. The artists were engulfed in this chaotic exodus.
A lot of people, you know, had left with their car, etc., left Paris at the last minute, and many people were killed on the roads, etc. It was a mess, you know. It was a tragedy, but it was also a mess. It was the most horrible feeling of defeat, as if you were no longer yourself.
The German advance pushed the avant-garde to the edges of France and beyond. Mondrian and Léger left in 1939 for America. They were later joined by Duchamp, Ernst and Chagall, forced out of the so-called unoccupied zone of southern France. Miro returned to Spain. Sonia Deloni hid in the Alps. Matisse moved to Nice. Picasso and Kandinsky returned to Paris. Soutine died in hiding. Otto Freundlich was killed in Auschwitz. Hitler had Paris to himself as he toured his favorite monuments, the Eiffel Tower, the Opera, the Arc de Triomphe. Nothing he saw offended him. Of modernism or degenerate art, there was no sign. The French themselves had already seen to that. Well before Hitler's invasion, they'd begun their own campaign against modernism.
The Germans arrived in a situation that was extremely propitious for their goals. Parisians felt that at long last they were among themselves and could look at the art that they really loved, the art of the fauve in particular, and all this kind of juste milieu, this middle of the road art that the mean foreigners with a sensibility totally different from theirs had imposed on them during all this period of modernism.
In 1937, a world fair was held in Paris. It was devoted to futuristic technology, and the pavilions built by each country were a good guide to their cultural preferences. The French had one pavilion designed by Le Corbusier and another decorated by the Delaunays. On the surface, this French contribution seemed progressive and brave. It certainly contrasted strongly with the ponderous pavilions built by the Germans and the Russians, with their massive columns and heavy idealism, the preferred architecture of dictatorship. But the impression of French modernity was misleading. The leader of the Front Populaire, then in power, Léon Blum, was a personal friend of the Delaunays, but his government was toppled in the first month of the exhibition by forces of the right.
What has given the 37 World's Fair its image of progressivity is what was done in temporary pavilions, things that have totally disappeared. When you look at what's left from that period, when you go to the Musée d'Art Moderne, which was not even finished then, that's how you know what was going on in the late 30s and who the state was patronizing. And it is indeed highly conservative.
The exhibition has been used to support a myth that Paris nurtured the avant-garde until the Germans marched in to stop them. But in truth, xenophobia and economic crisis had already created a culture extremely hostile towards modern art. One of the few modernist sculptors commissioned for the 1937 exhibition was the Russian Jew Jacques Lipchitz. His statue Prometheus inspired such vehement public outcry that the Parisian authorities withdrew the money to have it cast in bronze. Lipchitz had to exhibit his uncast plaster version on the Champs-Élysées. It was soon removed and destroyed.
L'affaire Lipchitz, qui est pris à partie très violemment par la campagne de presse, en particulier d'un journal qui s'appelle Le Matin, et qui dit qu'est-ce que c'est que cette gigantesque ordure aux abords des Champs-Élysées, et un discours extrêmement violent contre Lipchitz et qui très très vite dérive évidemment sur ses origines, et en particulier sur ses origines russes. C'est-à-dire qu'à l'époque, en fait, on accuse l'art russe, on accuse l'art allemand, l'art boche, parce que les Allemands sont encore les boches pour l'extrême droite avant 1939 et avant la collaboration, et on fait évidemment le passage très rapidement avec l'art juif.
We have decided to put the label dessinateur français on all our products. We have decided, in order to fight against the unfair competition of foreign draftsmen who have settled in France, to exclude them from this organization. The fact that everything was put in place before, Museum for French Art, Museum for Foreign Art, restrictions on foreign artists by law, quotas, exclusions, all of this was already in existence before the Pétain regime came in.
Et c'était l'époque où, effectivement, il y a eu un espèce de regain de classicisme incarné par Derain, et où on reparlait, on a toujours parlé, la tradition française, mais dans le plus mauvais sens, le sens à la fois classique et le sens anti-moderne, et montrant une sorte de figuration d'une énorme banalité.
The 1937 World Fair was devoted to this French love of conventional art. The best represented artist with 30 paintings on show was André Derain, a former revolutionary fauve. Derain had renounced his progressive ways and become the leading light of a popular painting movement called, rather sinisterly, the Return to Order. This tame representational art was echoed in the work of the most acclaimed sculptor of the period, Aristide Maillol. Maillol's limp and anodyne nudes were much more to the prevailing taste than Lipschitz's unbound Prometheus. Abstract art was out of favor. Non-French artists who employed strange forms and colors were ignored, or, like Kandinsky, confined to special exhibitions of foreign art. Modernist artists were starved of opportunities to show. But far worse was to come. To establish a sense of normality in occupied France, the Germans allowed cinemas, theaters, music halls, and galleries to reopen, as long as everything was submitted to the censors and no Jews or black entertainers were involved. For those prepared to rub shoulders with the occupiers, Paris under the jackboot glittered and giggled. The audiences for these wartime performances and exhibitions were always large and notably enthusiastic. Sometimes art was used for obvious propaganda. The 1942 Jew and France exhibition was held at the Palais Berlitz in the heart of Paris.
On alla jusqu'à voir tous les postes de commande de la maison France entre les mains des Juifs. Le résultat,
a subtle range of German propaganda techniques was employed to persuade the defeated French that the source of all present misery was the evil Jew in their midst. A stone's throw away from the Louvre, this building, the Jeu de Paume, was used by the occupying Germans to store works of art confiscated from French collections. Raids on Jewish collectors resulted in a huge haul of modern art.
C'est notre cadeau de mariage de Picasso.
André Gomez's wife, Henriette, promoted young modernists in her gallery. She championed modern art, and she was a Jew.
On sentait bien que ça allait très mal se passer. Henriette n'imaginait pas, Henriette était israélite, elle n'imaginait pas ce qui allait se passer après. Donc elle a fermé la galerie, elle a tiré la grille, et elle est partie comme si on partait en week-end ou en vacances. Seulement comme elle n'est pas revenue à Paris, la galerie a été saisie comme bien juif, et tout ce qu'il y avait dans la galerie a disparu.
The Jeu de Paume was used to store work confiscated from 203 different collections. 11,000 paintings in all, the great majority belonging to Jews. Modern works with market value were sold abroad. For the valueless, degenerate work, the Germans devised a more final solution. On the night of the 27th of July, 1943, they set fire to them.
C'était évidemment un acte éminemment symbolique, puisqu'il s'agissait de détruire 500 à 600 œuvres modernes marquées depuis le début art dégénéré par les nazis, donc responsables du pillage des œuvres d'art, en particulier dans les collections juives en France. Les artistes qui étaient brûlés donc au Jeu de Paume étaient des artistes comme Masson, comme Klee, comme Max Ernst, comme Picasso, comme Kiesling, des artistes comme Miro, bref, tous ces artistes donc, qui incarnaient vraiment les avant-gardes en France, les avant-gardes françaises et étrangères en France depuis l'avant-guerre.
The Germans banned avant-garde art from Paris, but they failed to obliterate the movement entirely. A few tiny galleries in Paris continued to show and sell so-called degenerate art under the counter. The ringleader of this black market trade in progressive ideals was the dealer Jean Boucher. She risked daily arrest by organizing a series of exhibitions of banned artists. Her gallery was often raided, and in 1942, it was shut down for mounting an exhibition of paintings by Kandinsky.
Recevoir des gens qui venaient plutôt de l'Est, d'Allemagne ou de Russie, ça a été difficile, d'une part parce qu'ils ne parlaient absolument pas la langue, qu'ils n'étaient pas assimilés à cette langue française, et ce qui fait que quand Max Ernst est venu, quand Harpe est venu, qui était alsacien mais pas parlant allemand, ou Lipschitz ou des gens comme ça, le seul endroit où ils pouvaient trouver un lieu d'accueil compréhensif, c'était chez Jeanne Bucher et dans le cercle de Jeanne Bucher. Ce qui était à la fois sympathique, mais très, très restreint.
Ironically, this suppression of the avant-garde, started by the French, completed by the Germans, was to give modernism a new impetus. This is the studio on the Rue des Grands Augustines, on the left bank of Paris, in which Picasso chose to live and work during the 4 years of the occupation.
The Americans had asked Picasso if he wanted to come to the United States, but Picasso had said he would stay where he was. He thought that was a form of passive resistance to stay there and be with the French people and through their ordeal and sufferings.
All over France, in the gloom of the German occupation, artists who wanted to work found their options reduced to a stark choice: to resist or to collaborate. What is surprising is not how little art was produced during the occupation, but how much.
I think that many art historians, including myself, felt that the entire war period was a period of blackness, that everybody was having a very difficult time surviving, and that art would be the last thing that people would be dealing with. As it turns out, it was a complete misconception.
People who had money, whether their money was honestly earned or not, they could not travel, they could not have a car, they could do nothing. So the only thing that was in a way a possibility of was to collect art. For example, at that time I was even surprised myself. I could sell my paintings very easily to collectors who would collect young artists, for example.
What's remarkable is that as early as 1941, there was a new feeling of normalcy. Shows were organized, new art publications, art columns, where the Jews had been, new figures appeared. And very quickly, the salons reorganized. And it seems that a rather lively art scene began again.
Removed from the scene was Picasso, who was living on the west coast of France in Royan when the German forces invaded. But in the early months of the occupation, the most famous modernist of all made an extraordinary choice. He moved back to Paris.
I met Pablo Picasso in May of 1943. I was having an exhibition of my work at that time, and I met him at a restaurant, and then he came to see my exhibition and then left a word that I could go visit his studio. The studio where Picasso worked during the war on 7 Rue des Grands Augustins was a part of a ancient, you know, an ancient building of the beginning of the 17th century, something. So it was quite quaint and beautiful at the same time inside. So he had two floors plus an attic. So the lower floor was where his secretary would try to sort out who was supposed to really meet Picasso or should be just left out.
Like other well-connected Parisians, Picasso did not suffer the usual deprivations of war.
With Picasso, it was no problem because, first of all, he was also, he is a person who didn't eat very, very much in any case, and he didn't drink wine or anything, so he suffered maybe less than some other people at that time because people who like food very much, well then certainly that was not the time, but for somebody like him, he just would go twice a day to a restaurant and get something, you know.
The dangers for Picasso were political. As a public enemy of fascism, he was exposed to constant surveillance and harassment from the Germans.
I think that Pablo Picasso was very much in danger at that time, because, first of all, he was Spanish. He had always been in favor of Republican Spain. He had never taken his passport from the Franco embassy. So, and it is, from what I have heard, that Franco himself, who had told the German that Picasso should not be allowed to exhibit any of his paintings in France during the war.
At the Liberation, Picasso emerged from his studio into the streets of Paris to witness the last cameos of the struggle. He was hailed as the most famous resistor in France, an image he encouraged. He presided over a committee set up at the Liberation to judge the culpability of fellow artists.
Picasso made himself out to be a great resistor to the American press right after the war. This was picked up by Alfred Barr, who published an article in the Art Bulletin where he was about to say, Picasso the resistor. He sent a draft of it, I think, to Zervos, who replied, please, do not make of Picasso a great resistor. He behaved with dignity. And then Zervos added, there were resistor artists. Unfortunately, their heroism was greater than their talent.
I don't know, I think that 50 years after that period, young people have imagination like, did Hugo put dynamite under a train? No, certainly not. I don't think there were many people who could do that, and those same people could certainly not have painted these paintings.
Picasso had a busy war, producing some 400 paintings, 1,000 drawings and sketches, and numerous sculptures, some even in costly bronze.
Nanita, nana, nanita, nana. Na, na, na,
his art was Picasso's most effective resistance, enduring acts of witness, suddenly haunted by the darkness of their times. He was the only great master of modernism who allowed the war into his art. But Picasso's war art was not inspired by the military machine. It came from all around him, in his own studio, in the gloomy, simple objects which surrounded him.
The radiator was not working because there was no coal to be put in the stove. And I think that painting is very incredible. In a way, it's also almost a criticism of the paintings of Matisse, you know, about windows that open onto a beautiful landscape, and inside there is a beautiful room with musical instruments or things like that. And whereas with Picasso, that painting on the first plane, you have the radiator, which looks like a kind of, you know, intestine or the guts of somebody, and it's all gray and rather dark and unpleasant. And then there is a window, but it opens on a landscape which is also, well, fairly abstract, but still there are houses, and then there are chimneys, but there is no smoke, you know, coming out of the chimney. So it's a comment that there is all that. It looks like if it's winter. And then to the left, there is a towel, which is white, you know, as if it's a towel maybe for the artist to clean his brushes, but there is nothing on it, as if it's the white flag that you agitate when you are really defeated, you know. So it's a comment on that time.
I think that it was thanks to Picasso that art kept the ability to deliver messages, subversive messages, which is a way of speaking about the avant-garde, the subversiveness of the content as well as the form.
Picasso's war effort was unique. There were other artists at work whose avant-gardist reputations did not arouse the fury of the Nazis. Artists whose work carried no politically subversive undertones, who continued painting the bel monde of France as if nothing had happened. Matisse, the master of French painterly elegance, also spent the entire war in France. You would never know it from his work.
Pour défendre et illustrer la force, la puissance de la tradition picturale, la vraie tradition française, et j'ai eu l'idée d'aller interroger un certain nombre d'artistes. Matisse représente une partie de la tradition française par sa clarté, par l'élégance de la ligne, par la puissance et la lumière de la couleur. Il incarnait aux yeux des jeunes peintres vraiment le grand maître qui servait d'exemple.
Matisse was well aware of his standing as the best-loved artist in France. He bought a ticket for Brazil after the fall of Paris, but decided to stay. If everyone of any value leaves France, what remains of France? Instead, in 1941, he moved to Nice. The south of France had long been his spiritual home. Matisse was 71, an old man whose chief concern during the occupation seemed, as ever, to be the pursuit of a gorgeous aesthetic dream. But Matisse was not entirely a neutral onlooker. He was the only major artist to make radio broadcasts for the collaborationist Vichy regime. As the most popular artist in France, Matisse's broadcast on official Vichy radio was an act of some significance.
What then of artists? Of what use are they?
They're useful because they can augment color and design through the richness of their imagination, intensified by their emotion and their reflection on the beauties of nature. We need only those painters who have the gift to translate their intimate feelings into color and design.
When you look at this Matisse still life from those years, describing a platter of oysters over here and a lovely vase of flowers and a jug next to it, on this lovely red background, there is no sense of tragedy whatsoever. Whereas if you compare it with a still life by Picasso, the contrast is striking. The forms are brittle and dark and tense, and the work is in black and somber colors, and there's a sense of imprisonment in the horizontal bars, and there's definitely a feeling of tragedy in the one which is impossible to detect in the Matisse.
On n'a pas un Goya à toutes les guerres. Hein. Matisse, c'était pas son problème de décrire la guerre. Il peignait ce qu'il sentait, il ne se forçait pas. Bon, Picasso a fait des peintures terribles pendant la guerre, mais il a fait aussi des peintures terribles après la guerre, pendant la paix. Bon, c'est pas... Vous savez, chacun a son tempérament. Il y a des gens au milieu des catastrophes qui trouvent le moyen de trouver une bouteille de vin, de la boire et de rire. Et puis il y en a d'autres qui vont se jeter dans le feu. Matisse, Chagall, il n'a jamais peint la guerre. Et bien d'autres. Vlaminck, qui était une ordure, a jamais peint la guerre. Et bien d'autres. Despiaux a jamais sculpté la guerre. Comment il s'appelait, Mayol, il a toujours fait ses femmes opulentes. Pourquoi ce reproche?
All in all, the painters of France did not mount an effective resistance to fascism. This was left to the poets and writers. Their clandestine presses produced large editions of defiant outpourings. Many writers were executed, but no French artists were killed for their art. In fact, in the entire war, only one album of resistance imagery was produced, and that not till 1944. Vaincre, to conquer, was published by the Front National des Arts, a resistance network run by one of only two artists during the entire war who dared to submit a subversive work to an official exhibition, André Fougeron.
Alors, évidemment, il y avait de la part de certains artistes, enfin, d'essayer de lutter quand même contre la présence allemande. C'était pas simple. Hein. Et ce tableau a été fait pour être exposé dans un salon. Il y avait un salon officiel, voilà, la preuve. En 1943, le 20e salon des Tuileries, carte d'exposant André Fougeron. Ils sont allés un jour chez Picasso, bien entendu, c'était là qu'il fallait d'abord aller. Son atelier était rue des Grands Augustins. Je l'ai connu, j'y suis allé, voilà. Mais les officiers, il y a un officier allemand qui, en regardant l'atelier, comment c'était, il y avait une reproduction de Guernica sur le mur. Et l'officier allemand, on dit en français « mi-figue, mi-raisin », lui dit « Ah oui, ça, c'est vous qui avez fait ça. » Il y a Picasso qui a produit « Non, c'est vous. » C'était fini. Ça suffisait. Ça, c'est une lithographie de Boris Taslitsky, mais c'est un dessin que j'avais réussi à obtenir de sa compagne pendant que lui était déporté à Buchenwald, et c'est moi qui est tracé sur la pierre. Ça, c'est Édouard Pignon. Ça, c'est encore Goergue. Et c'est encore Pignon. Et ça, c'est aussi encore Fougeron.
Unfortunately, when you look at the names of the artists who participated in that album, you found names that are very little known as compared to the names of the artists who went on that so-called propaganda trip to Germany in 1941.
Alors, Vlaminck, 1, Derain, 2, Despiaux, 3, Dunoyer de Ségonzac, 4, Vendongen, 5, Friese, 6, Bouchard, 7, Lejeune, 8, Belmondo, 9, il en manque 3.
These 13 artists, some of them famous, went to the extremes of collaboration. Accompanied by members of the Third Reich propaganda and art censorship ministries, they went on a two-week cultural tour of Germany, visiting major German cities and meeting approved Nazi artists. On their return, several of them blithely published their positive impressions of this notorious journey, instantly dubbed Le Voyage.
Donc il y avait une double trahison, il y avait une trahison politique et une trahison esthétique, ce qui est très grave pour les artistes, presque aussi grave qu'une trahison politique.
C'était de l'orgueil imbécile, mais c'était de l'orgueil. Mais oui, parfaitement. Et il y avait la satisfaction, c'est chez ces artistes-là, de dire « Hein, Picasso, maintenant, c'est fini ».
Pour les modernistes, la participation de Derain, de Vlaminck, de Vandongen, de Friese, qui avaient été des fauves, cette participation au voyage était d'autant plus choquante qu'ils avaient incarné cette modernité.
At the Liberation, Picasso said Derain should be shot as a collaborator. Today, Derain's art is being reacclaimed again in France. But not everyone can overlook his war record.
Mais son comportement, objectivement, est-ce qu'il est allé en Allemagne ou pas? Est-ce qu'il a répondu à l'invitation de Goebbels ou pas? Il l'a répondu. Bon, les motifs pour lesquels il a répondu, alors ça, c'est son affaire. Moi, je m'en occupe pas. Si vous, ça vous occupe, vous, c'est votre affaire aussi à vous. Mais c'est pas ça la question. C'est qu'il l'a fait. Et pendant ce temps-là, il y a des Français qui sont morts. Qui ont été fusillés, qui ont été déportés, qui ont été... Voilà, c'est tout.
Artists in France had a mixed war. A very few were eloquent witnesses like Picasso. Some, like Matisse, remained detached. Others, such as Vlaminck and Derain, were virtual collaborators. Modernism as a movement was in disgrace, banned from public exhibition and branded degenerate. But in the end, the antics of the fascists were to result in a new lease of life for modernism. Occupied Paris was not the only theatre of this war. The struggle had also spilled south, into the aesthetic minefield of Vichy France, the unoccupied zone. Many artists had taken refuge in Vichy France when France was invaded. The Vichy leader, 84-year-old Marshal Pétain, had shaken hands with Hitler and had made the Vichy policy of collaboration official and even acceptable. Pétain himself had no interest in the arts, but he was interested in developing a personality cult to emulate Hitler's. For this he needed the help of artists. The Jeune France group of painters was established specially to counter degenerate tendencies in French art. The head of arts in the occupied zone was Jean Bazaine.
C'était un art au service de l'État. C'était exactement comme Hitler. C'était un art qui défendait la Révolution nationale, une espèce d'illustration, si vous voulez. C'était le contraire de l'art, quoi. Pétain n'avait aucune idée de ce que c'était que la beauté.
Pétain n'avait pas de projet esthétique à proprement parler, ça n'était pas un fou, un esthète comme Hitler, loin de là, mais il avait ses vues sur la façon dont les artistes pouvaient représenter sa personne. Finalement, si on peut dire qu'il existait un style Vichy, ce serait un style centré autour de sa personne, le mieux représenté possible.
Working for Pétain, Bazaine organized an official Vichy exhibition of young artists called 20 Painters of the French Tradition. Bazaine's aim was to show that the Vichy establishment was not as reactionary as the Nazi regime, that Pétainist France, in the best French tradition, could still support a mild avant-gardism.
Ça commence par Bazaine, c'est parce que c'est un B. Baudin, Berceau, Berthold, Borès, Couteau, Desnoyers, Giscard, Lapic, Lannes, Lautrec, Le Gueux, Lemoyle, Manessier, Marchand, Pignon, Suzanne Roger, Saint-Gier, Talcott et Walsh.
But even these mild attempts to move away from wholly conservative art were condemned. Bazaine recorded the Vichy censor's reaction to the exhibition.
Le jour de l'exposition, quand il vit les toiles, il se mit à frapper le sol de son parapluie en criant « Mais monsieur, c'est un scandale ce que vous faites. Si vous osez appeler ça de la peinture française. »
Like Bazaine, many artists were initially fooled by Pétain's avuncular presence. In fact, Pétain's hatred of modern art was as ingrained as Hitler's. Almost as soon as they arrived in the south from Paris, the surrealists Max Ernst and Hans Bellmer were thrown into the French internment camp of Les Milles, a converted brick factory outside Marseille. The surrealists were persecuted for being foreign or Jewish, for their left-wing politics, or simply for being unconventional. In the eyes of the Vichy regime, surrealism was the most degenerate of all the modern isms, the most serious enemy of order.
I think the surrealists were the bête noire of French society at that time. They represented everything unconventional, subversive, different, anti-religion, anti-capitalist, that the French society really was afraid of in a sense and just didn't think was, quote, French. So they were oddballs in France.
From the Vichy internment camp, Max Ernst sent desperate messages to his friends in Paris, pleading for support. He was eventually released, but the arrests and threats of deportation intensified. Thousands of refugees had flocked south to Marseille, the last port in Europe with the potential for escape. There, Ernst joined his surrealist friends.
Je veux dire qu'à Marseille, ça a été le concentré de tout ce que nous avions connu à Paris, et nous avons retrouvé là tout le monde. Et sur 50 mètres carrés, il y avait tous les gens les plus intelligents de France qui étaient réunis là. Enfin, de A à Z, il y avait tout le monde.
As the regular roundups of Jews and political opponents by Vichy police and undercover Gestapo officers continued, the rush to emigrate intensified. Exit visas were automatically refused. Organizing escape routes for those trapped in Marseille was an itinerant art-loving American called Varian Fry.
Et alors nous travaillions dans un comité qui était fondé par Varian Fry, qui était un journaliste américain qui s'est présenté comme seul volontaire auprès d'une organisation qui s'appelait Emergency Rescue Committee, qui s'était fondée pour essayer de trouver un moyen de venir en aide aux artistes, aux intellectuels, aux anti-nazis, à des syndicalistes qui se trouvaient en danger en France et qu'ils espéraient pouvoir faire venir aux États-Unis.
Fry rented the Villa Herbel for the rescue committee and invited the persecuted surrealists to live there.
Alors là, ça sont des photos que j'ai faites à Marseille, à Herbel. Là, il y a la femme de Wilfredo Lam et Hérold. Comme il faisait froid et qu'on n'avait pas beaucoup de vêtements, Hérold faisait semblant de voler le par-dessus de Lam, parce qu'il avait dit, toi tu n'en as plus besoin, tu vas partir à Cuba, alors je vais te prendre ton par-dessus.
Banned from showing their work, the Marseille surrealists managed to organize impromptu displays for fellow artists and friends. Amongst them was another American friend, the wealthy heiress Peggy Guggenheim, who began smuggling surrealist art out of France.
Il y a eu une vente aux enchères, mais... Alors, Hérold vendait des tableaux de Bronner à Marcel Duchamp, qui n'avait pas un sou qui donc achetait pour 3 francs. Enfin, c'était plutôt un jeu, on passait le temps.
Bored, deprived of proper artists' materials, the surrealists whiled away their long days of semi-captivity by indulging in various art games. These sketches were begun by one artist, folded over and passed around the group to be added to until the paper ran out. Necessity became the mother of crazy artistic invention.
Il avait inventé un procédé, il imprégnait le papier de cire, il gravait dans la cire, donc le dessin est gravé dans la cire, et après il coloriait. C'était un procédé un peu spécial, et c'est lui, et il a fait de très 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 belles choses avec ce procédé.
Les traditionnalistes disaient depuis les années 30, il faut revenir au beau métier, il faut revenir au dessin, etc. Et donc ces artistes vont se faire un malin plaisir de détourner cette idée et finalement d'inventer un vrai métier, mais un nouveau métier.
The subversive surrealists and conformist Vichy could not coexist. On the 3rd of December 1940, all the surrealists, their families, the Emergency Rescue Committee, and 2,000 other suspects were rounded up. They were thrown into a prison ship moored in Marseille harbor. Marshal Pétain was coming to town. The streets had to be cleared of undesirables. It was the turning point. The surrealists decided to escape.
Alors pour ceux pour qui c'était possible, on leur faisait passer la frontière des Pyrénées à pied. Mais c'était une marche assez longue, et pour les plus âgés d'entre eux, pour les gens fatigués qui n'étaient pas habitués à marcher beaucoup, c'était pratiquement impossible.
Le petit personnage qui a les bras levés en forme de V à la proue du bateau, c'est Marcel Duchamp qui nous dit au revoir ou adieu. Enfin là, on espérait, c'était au revoir, heureusement.
In 1941, the Surrealists finally managed to flee from France, setting sail for New York, where Peggy Guggenheim and a new circle of American supporters awaited them. Making the journey with them was half a century of modernist ambition and achievement. The baton of modernism passed from Paris to New York, from the old world to the new. conservative collaborationist France paid dearly for her unwillingness to promote and protect the avant-garde.
The occupation period put an end to Paris as the center, as an international center, period. Because I think that what made Paris great was exactly what Vichy got rid of, the atmosphere of internationalism. What this image by Romanin showing a cafe with artists who are black, white, Jews, not Jews, all coming together could create. That was lost, I think, forever in Paris. And in that sense, the kind of internationalism, this kind of, which creates a synthesis from many directions, made of New York a new art center.
In New York, change was welcomed, progress encouraged. Modern art, weak and ailing before the war, its vitality almost burnt out, gained new purpose and life from its transatlantic transplant.
L'abstraction explose après la guerre en France parce qu'elle incarne sans doute la vraie démocratie, le conflit, la liberté, l'individu. Tout ce, finalement, contre quoi le nazisme avait lutté. La figuration même sera d'une certaine façon entachée par ce qui s'était passé auparavant. Il va y avoir, pendant des années en tout cas, l'idée qu'un artiste moderne, finalement, incarne quelque chose qui est contre la barbarie, qui est du côté du progrès, qui est du côté du changement, qui est du côté du mouvement perpétuel.
After the liberation, Paris fell back on peddling nostalgic myths about Montmartre and Montparnasse, and French museums stuck to their conservative buying policies. The key art innovations of the post-war, from abstract expressionism to pop art, had everything to do with New York and London, but very little to do with Paris. France had forfeited her leadership of the art world. Sous tes voiles, sous tes bris.